From NBC TV, Burbank, California, The Tomorrow Show with Tom Snyder.
Just thought it'd be fun to open up with Don Wilson tonight because we have four great broadcasters on the air. I love these shows because I don't have to do a damn thing but sit here and listen. We have Don Wilson with us tonight, George Fenneman, who spent years and years with Groucho Marx on You Bet Your Life, Harry Von Zell, who was with George and Gracie on Burns and Allen. He worked with Fred Allen, John Reed King. I'm the reason he's here tonight because I used to work with this man for Westinghouse in Pittsburgh. And in Philadelphia. And there's a great story I want him to tell about when he got canned by an executive at Westinghouse, and John Reed King went to the top guy and got the firing turned around. It's a super, super story. At least it was told to me, and I hope to the Almighty that it's true. Even if it isn't, he's going to tell it. A Don Wilson story I wanted to confirm about when he was sponsored with Jack Benny by Lucky Strike Cigarettes and came in coughing one night. And Benny says, "What's the matter?" And Wilson says, "Jack, these cigarettes are killing me." And they're sponsored by Lucky Strike. You had to be there to get the humor. Anyway, we have all those guys on tonight, and it's going to be fun. And we'll get to it in just a couple of seconds. Tomorrow night, we have Mr. Jack Valenti, who is president of the Motion Picture Association of America, who will discuss the performance of Vanessa Redgrave last night at the Academy Awards. And did you see what Patty Chayefsky said after she was all through with her talk? And Mr. David Rorvik, who is author of the controversial book called The Cloning of a Man. He claims that a human being already has been cloned. Thursday, advertising jingle writer Steve Carman and Dorothy Harold will be in here from LaPorte, Indiana. She is the current world champion all-time piano player. I don't know how this fits in, but she's going to be here on Thursday night. Monday, we have Michael Grumley, author of After Midnight, a book all about night people and why they consider the wee hours the most exciting. And on Tuesday night, a week from tonight, Irwin Schiff, the tax battler, is back to tell more about why we don't have to pay our income tax. And on the New York Times today, a little article. $6 billion misspent by health, education, and welfare. This isn't 6 million. This is 6 with 9 zeros after it. All right? The Department of Health, Education, and Welfare misspent $6.3 billion to $7.4 billion in fiscal 1977. That's just last year, folks. Because of waste, fraud, and abuse, the Office of the Inspector General said today. That amounts to about 5 cents of each dollar authorized in the fiscal year ending last September 30th, for which the department's outlay was $148 billion. $7 billion of our money they wasted, and we keep paying. Boob City. We're in Boob City. Joe Califano says the estimates, he is the Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare, he says the estimates are rough and incomplete. He said in some instances they may be too low. In other cases, they may be too high. Will somebody tell us what the hell they're doing back there? How can, I mean, if you and I weigh $6 or 60 bucks or 600, it's a catastrophe. These guys, $6 billion to $7.4 billion. Bureaucracy in action, and you can depend on it. Anyway, our show tonight, as I said, is Don Wilson and George Fenneman and Harry Von Zell and John Reed King. And we'll be right back with them after these words from our sponsors, so please stay tuned. Before you go, just hold it for 1 second, George. Remember Frank Field was here and we took him out for a $900 party and he hasn't called since. Cheapskate. Right back after these words from our sponsors. The illustrious gentlemen who are seated around me tonight represent 175 years in the broadcasting business. Each of them started out as an announcer, and each became a star in his own right. George Fenneman served with Groucho Marx and You Bet Your Life for 15 years. Harry Von Zell has enhanced the airwaves for more than 50 years with top stars from Fred Allen to Burns and Allen. Don Wilson was Jack Benny's friend, announcer, and sidekick for 35 years. And John Reed King's an old buddy from early days in Pittsburgh, who announced Grand Central Station, Texaco Star Theater, and produced such television hits as Death Valley Days and Sky King. You know, I didn't do any research. Usually I read up on people coming on this show, and I didn't do any tonight because I feel as if I know all you gentlemen. I've enjoyed you over the years, and so I don't know where to start except to ask John Reed King how we found him.
Well, I think that was the most amazing thing because we were sound asleep, and at 1:15 in the morning, the phone rang. There was somebody calling from Hollywood. Said, "Did you hear Tom Snyder tonight?" I said, "No, I'm asleep." And they said, "Well, he
make this a long answer because when it's over, yeah. You're going."
All right. He said, "Well, he wants you to call him right away." I said, "At this hour of the night?" I said, "I don't even know his number." She said, "Well, I'll give you the number to call," and she gave me the wrong number, and. But from then on, all night long, calls came in from all over the, mostly from the western part of the country, but from some as far as Chicago and Joliet, Illinois, and San Francisco. "Did you hear Tom Snyder? I mentioned your name." So the next morning, I got up, and I called the station, our local station. I said, "What kind of a rating does that guy have? And what are they getting for spots?" And it kept up for 2 days running. It's just
unbelievable. Well, I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're all here. Going around the horn, how did you all meet the people that helped to make you famous, if you don't mind my saying so? In your case, Groucho Marx, and in your case, Jack Benny, and you with Burns.
You seem
and
to
Allen.
Have trouble remembering that name, Benny. You want me to remind you every once in a while?
I've got a lot of names floating around in my head tonight.
You're doing very well. Yeah. Doing very well.
No, but how did you bump into Groucho and get the whole? What were you doing
you
before?
You don't bump into Groucho.
No.
And if you do, you're in trouble. Actually, I was on the corner of Hollywood and Vine. You believe me so
no,
far?
No, so far I don't. Just you like what's right. Your name was
true.
In the drugstore.
No, okay. True. No. I was on the corner of Hollywood and Vine. A fellow I had worked with in San Francisco, Bob Dwan, was doing a pilot for the Groucho Show. Mm-hmm. And he said, "Come down and audition." So I did, and I won the audition. And I sold Elgin American Compact.
How many guys did you have to beat in that audition?
I think there were about 30 there, and I have a terrible feeling that I came in second. But the guy who came in first was very hot at the time, and he wanted double scale. I worked, at this point in my career, I'd work, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
Under the table, even.
Cash, yeah.
It worked out very well.
How many auditions have you been through?
Auditions?
Yeah.
You want me to start counting? We don't
no,
have
but a,
enough time.
But a lot, really?
Yes. There was at a time when a new account would come in to the network, and everybody got called in and had to audition to see who was going to be picked as the announcer. Mm-hmm. And I must have done, I don't know, it would be...
Hundreds?
More than hundreds.
Yeah. Thousands?
Close to a thousand.
Are you scared every time, nervous every time?
I was petrified. I still am.
Yeah. I hated, I never had that many auditions, but I don't think that they're fair. Because you have to be better in the audition than you ever have to be once you get the job. You kick a word in the audition, out the door. Kick a word once you're on the air, they forgive you for it.
I think I was just lucky because I never really felt nervous. I've been frightened to death, but nervous never.
What's the most scared you ever were?
The most scared I ever was when they sent me down to meet the Normandy. We'd had reports in the news that she had undergone in her transatlantic voyage a frightful storm, mm-hmm. That there had been loss of life aboard ship, that the ship itself was a shambles. Well, they'll try to shorten it. I was sent by CBS down to cover the arrival and to interview people who had participated in that tragic voyage. And I sat, they put me in a chair because they didn't know exactly when she was going to move into her dock or pier. But finally she limped in and took her place at the pier, and people, they put down the gangplank. And the first 15 or 20 people came off were on stretchers. There were broken arms, broken legs, broken backs, and there an awful lot of people went through before I could find anybody to talk to. And I finally found a man, I motioned to him, and he came over, and I said, "Obviously, you have undergone a terrible experience." And he said, "I wouldn't want to try it again." But he said, "Actually, it was unbelievable. The force of the elements, the sea and the wind, working together to just seem to want to destroy the earth." Mm-hmm. seas that you couldn't even call them seas. They were mountains of water coming in all directions.
But why were you frightened?
I was frightened to see the mayhem occurred, that it could happen. This ship was almost as big as the Empire State Building is high. And I couldn't imagine anything that huge being tossed around like a cork. And this man described one salon that they had on the ship, in the center of which stood a huge oaken table, oak that thick. And it was used, you know, for special occasions, banquets, special dinners, and so on. And in the force of that storm, that table broke loose and started banging back and forth from one side to the other, and it just literally tore the whole insides of that room.
Yeah, no, I thought I was going to ask, you know, like when you were frightened just to go on the air, like the event was, like you weren't, maybe you weren't prepared or there were a lot of
people. Didn't even know I was on the air the first time
didn't?
I went out. No. We were. It was a little tiny radio station in Inglewood. This had to be 1923 or 4, somewhere. I didn't even know what radio was. I hadn't heard radio, didn't know anything about it. But I saw a bunch
of
people.
It's like Reed King. He's on a show he never watches. He'll be on tonight. He'll be in bed. He'll get a call. Say you're on a show. He'll say what show? What's the first one?
These people were standing around. You know, any time I see a group of people standing around, I have a natural curiosity. I want to know what's going on, and nothing was going on at all. But after a little while, they heard a lot of gravelly noises occurring, and then I heard some tinkling on a piano. Then I heard somebody singing. I said, "Where is this coming from?" And I maneuvered my way through this crowd that had gathered there, and here was this glass-encased room with a wire hanging down from the ceiling, and the noise was coming out of this thing hanging down. You don't believe this.
I didn't. I just want you to get to the end of it.
Well, I told you, it's a very short, long story. You know, if you want to go back another 50 years, it can be that twice as long.
I watched a show, an old show of yours this afternoon with Jack Benny, where the story was told of how you got the job as his announcer involving a corset company. Now, I don't know if that's a true story, but how did you become affiliated with Jack Benny?
Well, I don't have a dramatic story like George or Harry has.
What a load off my mind. Just kidding.
Was my story dramatic?
No, it was
really nothing dramatic about it. NBC had taken me into New York as a sports announcer, you may recall. And
you did the bowl games and stuff.
I beg your pardon?
You did the Rose Bowl games and stuff
like
that?
Yes, I did those for several years before going to New York. That's what got me to New York, as a matter of fact. Otherwise, they'd never heard the signal back there. But anyway... there was an audition came up for a comedian named Jack Benny who had been fired by the Chevrolet Motor Company, and he still had 13 weeks to go on his
contract
for the balance of the season. And every announcer on the NBC staff that didn't have a conflict, either time-wise or client-wise, and all the freelance men around town, I was included in the staff members at that time, and we were thrown into an audition, and I read a few lines of script with then Jack's writer, a fellow named Harry Cohn. Then Jack came out of the booth and Cohn went into the booth. I read a few lines with him and got the job. Now, there's nothing dramatic or romantic about that, but how lucky can a guy get?
Yeah, to be in the right place at the right time.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah. And 35 years with Jack Benny.
35 years.
Did you ever squabble, ever fight?
No.
What is it like working for a big star like Benny or Groucho Marx, or like you worked with Fred Allen? Because they are the stars, and you're kind of there at their pleasure.
Well, because of their greatness, they are great inwardly, too. At least Jack was. I can speak from that viewpoint. And he was a great man to work for. Jack was a perfectionist. He wanted his script done the way it was written, and he and his writers had spent a lot of time getting it together. But the performers were to perform as they were supposed to. We were supposed to be professionals, and he expected a professional treatment of the script. Mm-hmm. Really, nothing great and dramatic about it, but fun. You never have had more fun in your life.
I'll bet you. Now, like when Groucho Marx would try to get you to kiss the girl on the show.
Fun? You've never had more fun in your life.
You know, that's funny.
But he was always trying to get you married or have you kiss the girl or something.
The great thing about doing that show was that I had no lines. I had nothing.
But he wouldn't tell you, hey, tonight I'm going to put the zit on you again.
This was the great thing. I showed up and prayed that I'd say the right thing and do the right thing. Uh-huh. And we always made sure he had a pretty girl on the show, though, because mm-hmm. he seemed to perform better
yes.
when he did.
Most
and
of
I was pretty sure that I was going to be called out at some time during the show, and he would get me kissed
yeah.
or married or something right there in front of everybody, and then he would accuse me of paying him money backstage to have him. No, believe me, of course, I'm working with a hero. I was a little kid when I first saw the Marx Brothers, mm-hmm. really. And suddenly I'm on the stage at, I guess I was 26, with this man. Mm-hmm. And I was not hired to talk to Groucho. I was hired to sell these Belgian-American compacts.
That's
and
right.
The first commercial, the first show.
Do they make those anymore?
We put them out of business immediately. Oh. sad true story. We were so successful with that show the first year. They sold so many compacts that they overextended themselves. They built another factory, but they didn't think of the fact that the show had escalation clauses and they got more expensive. They couldn't afford the show after a while, and you've never heard of them again. The first time I was on that show, and I started to read this Belgian-American compact commercial, and the violins swell at the end of it, mm-hmm. and I say very close to the microphone, "Have you looked at your compact lately?" That's when Groucho started talking to me.
Well, that's when sex and radio came in, and you're to blame for it.
And from then on, I became a part of the show every week, a little more.
Do women have compacts anymore?
I don't think so.
Sure.
Yes. Do they?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
What do they with the hard powder and the puff?
Oh, I haven't seen that. For years, I haven't seen that.
Oh, yeah, but they're beautiful little fancy things. It costs three times what they're worth.
Well,
yeah.
That's what we were selling, too. The same thing.
And let me tell you something, Harry. They don't put powder in them no more.
No. We'll be
back after these words from our NBC stations. Please stay tuned.
Looked at the man like he had two heads. They said, "I don't what."
Harry,
what
do you teach? We're back on start over again, where they called you from the school to teach announcing.
Where?
No, from the beginning. You know, the Normandy's coming in. What? The table is left.
All right. Yeah.
No, but you just asked him, Don.
It was on Pier 2. Hmm?
No. What you were just asking, Don.
What?
About the radio school.
Yeah, ask him. Did you ever get into one of those?
Yes, things? I did, Harry. Wasn't that Ben Bard? He had a dramatic show.
Yes.
Ben Bard, and a fellow by the name of Stein had his radio division, as I recall.
No, what I'm getting at is that you said they called you to teach announcing.
Teach announcing,
how
yes.
do you teach announcing?
Well, that's what I asked them. I said, how do you teach people to talk? And if you can't talk, you can't announce. And there's no way you can announce without talking, so... You have to teach
You got a
them.
Point there, Harry. Although, listen to some of the guys on the air today, you wonder, don't you?
The whole thing baffled me. I finally threw my hands up and said, I don't know. It's your school. You teach them.
Exactly.
Teach
well,
them
I
to talk.
I didn't either with the school. I didn't like the smell of it.
Oh, shoot, I couldn't understand what they were thinking about. You cannot teach people to talk.
Well, they've also got to be able to read intelligently.
Well, that's another thing.
Surely.
Supposing they can read intelligently and still can't talk.
They both need to hold for yourself.
You know, when you mentioned the Normandy story, I was thinking about...
Don't go back to it, John.
Well,
that's all over.
When the yep. Normandy first came
Because otherwise
to New York,
this will become the Titanic.
You've got to tell this one.
And there's no dancing
well.
Here, John.
The Normandy first came to New York, and they had everybody... There was Paul Douglas was on board the ship. They went out, the pilot, and they had another man on board the ship, and Bob Trout was flying overhead in a balloon, and I was on the shore, and as they swing it around into the pier, you know, that long swing with the tugs, long delay. So we were killing time, you know, and I said, and now let's ask so-and-so, to forget the guy's name on the ship, what are they doing now? He said, the sailors are manning the winches. And that blew me right off the air.
This man committed the greatest blooper I've ever heard on the
True.
Air.
Oh, no.
True. Oh, yes. With the when you were doing the President of the United States back in 1930-31.
You think that was a great blooper? Huh?
It was terrific.
Well, I can give you a greater one.
All right.
Fella, a very nice man. I later got to meet him. He was from St. Louis. And he was an announcer. And they gave him a piece of copy to read one evening as he was going on the air. He did news and of course, did some commercials. And there was a dry cleaning establishment that had a nice announcement for him to make, consisting primarily of the main, very straightforward statement of ladies. Any of you who wish to drive by and drop off your clothes will be given immediate attention. Everything stopped. Biggest laugh. We couldn't hear it, but the mail came in and said, would you say that again, what you said? Because we heard it, we didn't believe it, and we've been laughing ever since.
Now, you said in the break that he got you your first job or helped to get you your first job?
He actually was the cause of my getting my first job. I had been working in high school and college locally in Atlantic City, and when I got out of college, I went around auditioning everywhere. And I finally got a job with WBAL in Baltimore. And the night before I was to leave, they called, and they said, Harry Von Zell is leaving to go with George Burns and Gracie Allen to the coast, and we want you to take his spot on the staff. And that's how I got the job.
Yeah.
And from there to First Savings, quick, easy step, 45 years.
Harry got me my latest job.
You both are the voices and the spokespeople for a savings and loan company.
Yes,
in Los Angeles.
Tom, may I interrupt you?
Yes, you may. since I
Harry,
wasn't saying anything.
Do you remember when we first met and what the circumstances were?
No.
Well,
you have to give me time to think. Now, you're going back.
Did the call letters KMTR mean anything?
KMTR, of course.
What was your capacity there?
At that time, I was the manager of KMTR.
That's right. I'd gotten fired from KHJ, the Donnelly station here, because I bought a Packard that was...
It was the wrong car.
The Packard was owned by KFI, Earl C. Anthony. And Anthony and Donnelly were...
Competitors.
Oh, competitors. They were enemies in both the communications media and in the automotive business. So I got fired for buying a Packard while I was working for Donnelly. And I rang every doorbell around town, and in those doorbells that I rang was at the station called KMTR. I didn't know who the manager was. I walked in, and it was Harry. Do you remember your reply?
No, I don't.
Get rid of that.
Well, you turned me down, you son of a gun.
I did?
Yes, sir. You turned me down.
Well,
and afterward.
Well, what was his reply?
He said, no, we don't have any place for you.
Don't have any place for you.
And Harry told me several days later, he said, I couldn't possibly have given you a job because I worked for a man named Ben McGlashan, I believe it was, and he said, Harry said, he could have fired me 5 minutes later. I didn't know whether I was going to have a job or not.
Well, there was another very fundamental reason. They didn't have any money.
Well, that you didn't divulge.
I was working for nothing.
Have you ever been canned?
Literally.
Oh, that's a likely story.
Literally.
You want to work it out with me?
Wait, I'll tell you. Why don't we go over here and we'll talk, okay? And play a few hands
of
gin.
I want to board the ship again.
Yeah, right. Yeah. No, I was just asking Harry, or George. No,
I'm George.
Yeah. If he'd ever been fired.
No.
And I've forgotten. I don't think so. You lose accounts. I mean, things happen. In fact, the announcer, I think the gentleman will bear me out, when a new agency comes onto a show or something, the announcer's the first to go.
Yeah.
Because that's the person they can get rid of, you know, mm-hmm. and they bring in their own fella. I guess I've lost things there and that terrible rejection.
Is it hard, like, when the sponsors are in the booth and they're telling you to say the name of the product this way or hold the box this way, stuff like
that? Oh, yeah. There are times when it is. I've been fortunate. I've had long runs. You know, I had Lipton tea for 9 years. I felt a member of the Lipton group, really. You know, mm-hmm. A lovely kind of experience.
Probably to this very day, little boxes of Orange Pico arrive at your front door.
No longer.
Stuffed with cash.
No. Well,
the boxes he has today are filled with gold from home savings.
You got fired once, didn't you?
Yeah, I got fired once at Westinghouse. I don't have all the details that clearly in mind. Fortunately, I have forgotten most of the incident, but in essence, you said right at the beginning of the show, they had the chairman of the board said, you know, we're not worried about when you get old and all that. And suddenly I had gray hair. Well, not suddenly. I'd had gray hair for a long time. And they said, you're getting pretty old. You're out, you know. Mm-hmm. And I went to the chairman, you know. I said, Mike, just the other day, you're out, you know. And it was a real axe job. I have done other axe jobs on other people, I guess, but this was retribution of a sort that really hit me between the eyes. Mm-hmm. Strangely enough, though, ABC had called me just a little while later, and I came to the Coast for them, and that's how I came to the Coast.
Mm-hmm. Well, to refresh your memory, you were working for the Eyewitness News team at
that's
KDKA.
Right. That's right.
And an executive whose name was Jack Riley said that you were getting too
old.
You
said it, I didn't.
That's right. Hey, hey, Jack, Jack's a friend of mine.
Is he really?
You know, and Jack dumped on me back then, so yeah. Here comes my retribution. Dump on Jack Knight.
What's his name again?
Jack Riley. Used to look at his shoes a lot. Always looking at the shoes, you know, right, Jack? Huh? With the cute wife?
Oh, God. You anyway, got him down.
No, no, but it was all resolved amicably. John Reed King went back to the Eyewitness News, and Jack went to the light bulb company. It was terrific when they got finished with it. We'll be right back after these words from our sponsors and our other friends, so please stay tuned. Jack Guy here's looking at you.
Some guests on The Tomorrow Show stay at the Sheraton Universal Hotel, a Sheraton Showplace Hotel. For reservations, call free 800-325-3535 or have your travel agent call.
Say, listen, when you were all working in radio and television came in, was that hard at first?
It was fun.
You bet it was.
Or were you scared of it?
Oh, it was a killer, yeah. Tom. Making the transition from radio to television was tough on everybody. You were up there, you had to memorize everything. Now, on radio, of course, you read your script. But, of course, in television, now you're memorizing everything. And it was a chore by everybody involved. And it was also a chore by everybody involved back of the camera, including the control room. They all shared in it. It was so much experimental.
But how about when you first got on the street and now people had seen you the night before? You know, radio, you could walk down a street and nobody would ever know who you were. But when they can see you and then the next day they say, oh, there's George Fenneman. I saw you on television. That's got to be a big kick.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Well, it's startling.
It is really. And still, it still amazes me that people care.
Mm-hmm.
But it works for me, too, when I see somebody. Like, I don't know you, but if I'd seen you outside, you know, in a restaurant or something, I would have walked up probably because I figured I did know you.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the difference between, like, on a motion picture screen, there is a barrier. I don't feel that way about actors. I don't run up to them. But I catch myself walking across a room to say hello to somebody I don't know.
You see us every day.
Mm-hmm.
Every day. Whereas a movie star, you see once every 3-4 weeks or 3-4 months or something like that. And there isn't that familiarity between the audience and the people.
Tom, I think one of the most amazing things is the voice identification that many of us in radio at that time enjoy. They've never seen you, perhaps have never seen a photograph of you. And you can be in a restaurant and somebody with your back on the other side of it will have the waitress come over and say, is that Don Wilson or is that Harry Manzel or so on and so forth? And you turn around and they identify you by hearing your voice.
That's right.
So that's a very, very important function. And it still happens today, I'm sure, to all of us. I know it does to me.
It's very difficult. I think, especially in my little area, because we're just in the central part of California, and everybody knows everybody else. And you go up and somebody smiles, you know. And you're not sure, do I know the guy or has he seen me, you know? And it's a moment of indecision, you know. Hi. Are you going to say hi or are you not? And it's really frightening.
There are some wild moments,
wrong
though,
things,
when those people come up to you sometimes and they look at you and they say, didn't you used to be somebody?
Yes.
I know they don't mean that.
Or,
I know they don't mean
or,
that.
Who are you?
Yeah.
And then you tell them, they say, no, you're not.
No. Oh, the one I love is if you're in the elevator, like when you live in New York and you're on the tube there, and it's Saturday night and you're not on the air and you're going up to see a friend, right? And they say, how come you're not working tonight?
Yeah.
They want to know why you're not working.
Yeah, yeah.
And boy, if you ask them how come they're not working, they hit you in the mouth. You
know? One time a guy came up to me in Grand Central Station. He said, I know you. You're John Watson. I said, no, I'm not, and I walked away.
Well, people, for some reason or other, in my case, it's always been, there'll be somebody walking toward me, and all of a sudden there'll be an expression, and say, so here comes something, because he's got a bead on me. He's walking right, you know, nose to nose. And he says, how long has it been?
I think to be recognized by the public.
But he thought we went to school today.
Your answer is not long enough.
Not long enough. I don't have any how long it's what been.
I think to be recognized by the public that way is one of the greatest forms of flattery.
It is.
We can all be very, very grateful for it, whether it's the voice identification or the physiognomy or the combination of both. I think it's one of the
Which?
Most flattering
if
things.
If he says that again, I'm
What's the physiognomy?
He's an announcer, you know. Physiognomy, that's a hard one.
Yeah. Look it up in the dictionary.
What is it, the way you look?
What's a dictionary?
No, the way your face looks.
Sure.
Say, what are you up to now besides the savings and loan?
Oh, dear.
Well, I do a show here, a local show on NBC.
On KNBC, yeah. Right, called On Campus.
On Campus. Oh, found us?
Yes, I have.
They move us around quite a bit on that show.
Yeah.
It's an interesting show because I get to visit the 15 independent colleges of Southern California. I'm on the board of directors, and, it's kind of a labor of love.
You know reading and writing and all that stuff?
Oh, yes. And I did a show here, too, called Talk About Pictures that... we bought back, my partner and I, and we put it in syndication, for which NBC has never forgiven us.
No.
But it's done rather well, but they haven't played it here locally.
You must be a very rich man.
Yes, I am. And Harry owns
the
world's largest.
We are both very wealthy. Insofar as the blessings that have befallen us, I think we are both very wealthy.
Yeah, you know, it's
He's
true.
Wealthier than I am.
A wonderful way to make a living, really. And you know the great thing? It wasn't until lately that those actors found out what announcers did. And now they're showing up at the auditions. And some very large names.
John Wayne. It's a funny thing. Like, you guys all did the news at one time.
Mm-hmm.
And I was an announcer. We all did the news. Right. We did the sports. We did the weather. We did the records. We did the whatever it was to do. You did it. But somewhere along the line, they bifurcated, and all of a sudden, the announcers couldn't do the news anymore. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And if you call a newsman an announcer, they get upset, you know? And I always like to be called an announcer.
I think that's
a very nice title. I feel very comfortable
there
with
There aren't
that
announcers
title.
Really anymore,
no.
though, there, as we knew them.
No, where formal you did, announcing.
You did all those things.
Yeah.
You know, my first job, a local station in San Francisco. I'd never worked in a radio station before. I'm doing a live thing like this at the top of the mark the second day.
Yeah.
I did news, I did the records, we all did those things. I went down to the dock and watched the ship come in.
Yeah, and praying to the Almighty that it sounds okay and you're not going to get canned the next day.
Yeah, yeah.
You were speaking about doing the news. At the time...
Donald,
the
can I interrupt you for a second? I've got to get these spots in, and a guy just dropped a can over here, which I have to pick up. So we'll be right back after these words from our NBC stations. I think they're beginning. Don Wilson was about to say about the news.
Oh, yes. When the press radio news was first instituted, do you recall, by the networks, Harry?
Yes.
The assignment at NBC, McNamee and I drew the assignment. One night we'd be on the red, the next night on the blue. The greatest way to get fan mail in the radio business in those days, in my opinion, was to mispronounce the name of somebody's hometown.
Mm-hmm.
The Heavens fella.
Oh, sure.
You really got it. And these little Indian names of towns in Arkansas or wherever they were, anybody could guess the pronunciation and it would be wrong. But the populace, such as it was, showered down on you, but good. You recall
that? That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, it was
unforgivable. They're still doing it to the state of Oregon. The Eastern broadcaster calls it Oregon. And you know that he's never been out to the West Coast. Little bits of information we announce as drop on you, Tom.
Wait, say it again. Oregon.
Oregon, yeah.
And back east, they say Oregon.
Oregon.
Oregon, yeah.
Gee, I never thought of that.
It's one of those little things that...
Oh, start another war.
You remember we had a guy on CBS, whose name escapes me, thank goodness, but he was a guy that could... Harry used to do March of Time, too, with the Westbrook Van Voorhees.
Yeah.
And this guy was able to do Westbrook Van Voorhees down to the T. I mean, he could get the voice up and then...
Charles March of Arlington.
Let's not use the names.
Why not?
Because
we're ready to hear the story.
One day they called, he did all the news. Paul White thought he was the greatest. Paul White was a news director. And he'd go in and do the news, you know. And one day they sent him into the studio the day George V of England died. And he went on the air and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt this coast-to-coast broadcast to bring you a bulletin from London, England. George the V is dead.
George the V? It's a joke.
I have to say.
That wasn't the fellow you mentioned.
No, that wasn't his name.
The funniest tragedy that I have ever heard come through a radio speaker was one Sunday morning, Easter Sunday, and NBC had put out publicity. They were going to do a very special program. They had about 2 hours of the most touching religious music, chorale, orchestra, just beautiful, and it wove a spell that by the time it came up to the minute when they were going to pick up the Easter address of Pope Pius V, mm-hmm. Howard Claney,
Yes.
drew the announcing assignment, and you came to those 2 minutes of silence. You felt close to heaven, believe me. You felt sacred. And then this mellifluous voice of Claney saying, "Ladies and gentlemen, the next voice you shall hear, speaking to you directly from the Vatican in the holy city of Rome, will be that of Pipe Popus the Poop three times.
Howard was a meticulous reader. He's one of the best readers in the business.
You know what he did? He couldn't face a microphone. He left New York. He went left New York. Went to Paris for 2 years. Studied art.
Well,
came back a very accomplished artist. He was a good artist to begin with. And was able again to face a microphone. But it took over 2 years for him to get over that one little slip of the tongue.
Well, we were talking earlier about boo-boos and fluffs, but Harry, you never voiced to Tom, I don't believe, the question, an answer to the question he asked you about your famous...
Well, there's no answer to that.
One of the greatest fluffs uh-huh. that ever was on
it's
the radio.
It's a classic.
It's absolutely a classic.
Well, it depends on who did it. If somebody else would have done it, I would have envied them.
Hey, you know, if you want to give it to me, I'll take it.
Yeah.
Boy, I can do a lot of after-dinner speeches on that one fluff.
If you want to sign a paper saying that you were the fellow that said in wishing happy birthday to one of our great presidents and called him Heber Hubbard. Then you
Heber Hubert.
What did you say?
Hubert Heber.
I didn't say anything intelligible at all.
And now the president of the United States?
We were wishing him a happy birthday.
Oh.
And we had it short-waved all over the world. And we had, said we were going to, at the proper time. We in New York, we in the United States, you in Australia, you in Austria, you in Lithuania, wherever. All in one voice now comes the climax to a 7 pages of eulogy that I read through without breath, without mistake, without any, just perfect. Now I got one thing to say, ladies and gentlemen, now is the time. Let us all together in one voice wish happy birthday to our president.
It hurts me to think of it.
I walked steps down those steps outside of the big studio on the 22nd floor of the Columbia Broadcasting Center building, and there were the windows. And I went to the first window, and it was inoperable. They were fixed windows. If any of those windows had been operable, I'd have been out the window and down in Madison. It was the end of the world.
Oh, that wasn't.
Things were very serious.
I'd like to tell you one that I pulled at one time. On the Benny Show, I was waxing very erudite about something. I don't know what it was. And Jack interrupted me.
Say, for the record, let me interrupt you.
Yeah.
Did you say the line that my father attributed to you, that you came in one night coughing to beat the band and you were on the air for a cigarette lucky strike and Benny says to you, "Don, you're huffing and puffing and out of breath. Why?" And you said, "Well, the elevator was stuck and I had to run up 9 flights of stairs and these cigarettes are killing me."
I wish I could take credit for that gag. I think it's a daddy. No, I don't think your father was correct. But I was waxing very erudite this particular night on the show, and Jack turned to me and he said, "Don, I'm amazed. Where did you learn all that?" And I said, I read it in Dreer Poussin's column. Well, if you remember, Jack, if anybody made a fluff on the air, Jack made capital of it instantly. Well, that Dreer Poussin gag stayed with me for a long, long time, and every once in a while, Jack would refer to it. It was always good for a laugh. But we've all done inadvertent things like that at one time or another.
I had one.
It's your turn to be interrupted. I'm sorry, George, but I have to break away for these announcements. We'll be right back with George Fenneman after these messages.
What does that mean?
You're on, Charlie.
I've never seen anybody do that before. Speaking of fluffs, right?
Fluffs, right.
Seems like yesterday. I was on a show called Sweeney and March, a radio show.
Oh, yeah.
They were ahead of their time. Really.
Yes.
I was an actor on this show, and I had the payoff line to a big sketch, and the payoff line was, who's been feeding whiskey to these natives? Well, we had a studio audience, and we all showed off a little bit, so I strolled up to the microphone, and I put my script down, because I'm going to deliver it from memory, right? Whole sketch is built up to who's been feeding whiskey to these natives. I turn to the microphone, and I say, who's been giving bananas to these monkeys?
Where that came from, I'll never know. Somewhere back here. Oh, wow.
I tell you, the great thing, though, in those days, it was live. We had a second show to do because of the time differential. Mm-hmm. So I got to be good on the second show, and I took my script up, I read it word for word, and I got applause.
From the cast.
From the cast. Nobody at home knew what they were
about. I never take your eye off the script.
Right,
never.
I learned.
Speaking of the second show and live, are you involved in things now where they make you do retakes over and over again? You know what I mean? One more time? And,
I think all of us, a good answer to that. You do a thing on film or tape, and you have that luxury in the booth of saying, let's try that again.
Yeah, it was very
and
good.
And after a while, you get so sick and tired of the line or whatever you're doing.
Yeah, I wonder why they do that to us, because it's happened to me on shows where they say, let's try it again, and I say, why? Well, let's just try it again.
Mm-hmm.
We'll save this, but let's do it one more time.
What I also love is when you do it the second time, they come out and they change all the lights.
Mm-hmm.
I wondered why they were doing the thing in the first place with the lights wrong.
Yeah.
Have you just lost a lighting man here? Am I in the dark now?
No, it's...
I'm just kidding, guys.
Just getting older, George.
They just plain don't like us.
I guess that's
they hate us. They're going to get even with us for what? We didn't do anything.
Well, there
we
is
just
a,
go there.
There is a legitimate excuse on many, many occasions for that fella. There could be some little technical quirk or some technical function that didn't perform correctly. So rather than blame it onto the technical department and the equipment, they blame it on the announcer to do it again.
Oh,
this is
you know that, do you know that last night we're doing a show here with a girl from New York, and we got a piece of videotape that we're showing of an airport scene. And they come out and they say, tell the audience that during this videotape, there's color shift. Now, do you think that anybody who's watching this show at 1:45 or 2 in the morning gives two hoots if there's color shift in the videotape? They don't care if there's no color at all if they're watching at this hour. I don't care. And this is not to put down my audience, but audiences, or the other one is when they come with the microphone and you can't see a wire, you know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
And I say, hey, wait, they're smart out there. Very bright. They know that we have to have microphones on. They don't mind seeing them. They don't mind seeing a cord. You know, this doesn't work by magic. It's all electricity, and it's got to have a cord. And they go nuts. You got to hide it under here and a piece of tape in here. And then, you got the wireless, and you know where they put the antenna. Mm. Oh. And that can hurt. I'll tell you, the rectal mic hurts a lot.
There is a luxury, though, in having the second take. Back in our old CBS days, I used to do the news a lot in the morning. I used to have a 10 o'clock in the morning news, and we did it on the 23rd floor, and they sent it up from the 16th floor, rip and tear.
Mm-hmm.
And one day I got up there waiting, and at 30 seconds to hear, no tape, no news. Suddenly it was 10 o'clock, and the guy behind the camera goes like that. And I look down, there's a copy of the New York Times lying on the desk. So I pick up the Times, you know, and I'm reading the first two paragraphs of each story, and I'm one eye on the clock, and I work through the front page, and I'm working on the second page, and finally the 1/4 hour is up, and I say, that's the news, this is the Columbia Broadcasting System. I put it down, the engineer came in, I said, how'd you like that?
He said, that was yesterday's Times.
Oh, and it was.
Oh, the crazy things that happen.
Say, now, you two are about to be inaugurated into something called the Broadcasters Hall of Fame, which is in Freehold, New Jersey, on the 21st of May.
Yeah,
that's right.
Will you be returning to the fabled city of Freehold, New Jersey, for this auspicious occasion?
Mm-hmm. Harry, I'm delighted to hear that you're to be inducted at that time.
You haven't answered the question. Are you going to Freehold for the occasion?
That's right. We are going to Freehold.
Are you
going to
go?
Surely I'm going.
Really?
I went last year.
It's cold there.
Well,
not in May it isn't, Harry.
But that...
No. In Freehold, it's cold.
I am so delighted that at last our industry has gotten a Hall of Fame similar to the baseball, the football, the golf, the tennis Hall of Fame, to give some recognition to the great people who have been in our industry, excluding myself. And I think it's just wonderful that that kind of recognition has been given. They've got quite a museum back there, too, in Freehold, with a great deal of memorabilia, and it's well displayed, and it goes back to the early, early days that were very primitive from the engineering standpoint,
yes,
too.
Yes.
It's just great. Hadn't you planned to go, Harry?
No, there's no way I can go. You see, you fellas can fly.
That's right.
I can't.
Well, why not?
I haven't been able to fly for 35, 40 years.
Why?
Really?
Something happened to the inner ear here, and I daren't leave the ground.
Oh, well, they got a train. And when you get off that train, you'll be glad you're in Freehold.
you show me a day in the week when I've got time to go to New York on the train.
Gentlemen, I'm out of time. Thank you, Mr. Von Zell, for being here tonight.
Mr. John, Von Zell,
yes,
please don't do
John
that.
Reed
makes
King,
me feel
thank
younger.
You, sir. Don Wilson, thank you. And George Fenneman, I've enjoyed meeting you
thanks
tonight.
Thanks, friend.
Nice to be here.
Will continue after these words from our NBC stations.
Thank you.